In genetic genealogy, there are several different ways to look at the amount of DNA. And today, I'm going to go over how we can look at DNA in different ways and how you can see all those ways on one website. Howdy, I'm Andy Lee with Family History Fanatics, and this is a segment of DNA. Be sure to subscribe to our channel and click on that bell if you want to be notified about upcoming episodes. When we're looking at DNA, there are different ways that we can describe how much DNA we may share with somebody else. There's different measurements for the amount of DNA that we have. So let's go over what each one of those is and how it might be useful in genetic genealogy. The first is the easiest to understand, and that is megabases. And what this is an absolute measurement of the position along that chromosome. We have about 3 billion base pairs on each set of chromosomes. And so a chromosome may have hundreds of millions of base pairs. A megabase just means a million bases. And so it shortens it down to a number that's really easy to understand. So if you are looking at position 28 megabases, then that is the 28 millionth base pair along that chromosome. Because we use different standards of the human genome, each build is going to have slightly different numbers for a particular position. And that's why you want to know what build you're using. For almost all of the genetic genealogy websites, they use build 37. And so if you make sure that you're always using build 37, then it's always going to be the same as far as the megabase location. Now the next way that we measure DNA is by centimorgans, or CM. Now centimorgans is a lot more difficult to understand because it's not a simple location of you go so many places and that's where you're at. What a centimorgan is it's actually based on a probability of recombination. Now, that may sound really confusing, and for the most part, it is, because it's unlike anything else that we actually measure in most of the rest of the scientific world. Now, because this is a probability, the amount of centimorgans varies from chromosome to chromosome, and it varies along a chromosome. You might have one place where centimorgans are really short and another place where centimorgans take up a lot of megabases. And so that's why it can be really confusing. However, because this centimorgan is related to recombination, it is probably the most important measurement in order to compare two different people's DNA. And so it's the one that is used most often in genetic genealogy. On average, and again, this is just average across the entire human genome, about 1.25 centimorgans is equal to 1 megabase. However, there are lots of places along the human genome where that is higher or even lower. For instance, chromosome number 19, it's actually almost 2 centimorgans per megabase, whereas chromosome number 2, it averages about 1 centimorgan to 1 megabase. But again, along each one of our chromosomes, the amount of centimorgans per megabases varies quite a bit. The good thing for all of us is all of your genetic genealogy websites will automatically calculate how much centimorgans you share on a particular segment. Now the third type of measurement is a snip distance. And what this is the number of snips between two different locations. A snip is a place on the genome where the letter can actually vary. And so that is the place where we actually see variety among all of the people that have tested. Each company uses a unique set of snips, and they use about 500,000 to 700,000 snips that they're testing whenever they test your DNA. And as I've explained in other videos, the amount of overlap between two companies' tests varies from anywhere as low as 10% to as much as 90% or more in some cases. And so this is what you're actually comparing with other people. So since we have these three different scales, you might be wondering, well, where could we actually see the different things? For instance, Most people are familiar with the Centrimorgans because they have seen that whenever they see a match of how much Centrimorgans they match. If you've gone into segment data, you might have seen the Megabases as well. And you might have seen how many SNPs make up that segment. That, on a basic level, is those three scales. Now, gedmatch actually has a way where you can see all three of these scales at one time. And you do that by using the one-to-one comparison. What you need to do when you're doing your one-to-one comparison is make sure that that checkbox for full resolution is checked. This is going to make a graphic file that covers a big long area of the screen. You're gonna have to scroll quite a ways to see everything. So here is a segment of DNA, and this is between myself and my grandfather, and this is on chromosome number 1. And what you can see is you can see the parts where we're matching, which would be the yellow and green, and it has the blue bar indicating that that's a half match, and the parts that we don't match, which would where there's some red intermixed in that, and that's a black bar underneath showing that we don't match. Well, the SNP scale is the easiest to see on here because actually it is every single pixel represents a single SNP. Most of the time. We'll get to the exception here in just a moment. So each one of these bars along here represents a SNP that we either share completely in common, or we just share half in common, or in the case of red, we don't share in common at all. What's more, if you look really carefully, you can see that there is a little tick mark underneath the black or blue bar, just a straight tick mark. And those are all at even intervals all along this chromosome. They represent about 100, or in some cases, 200 SNPs. Now, this is where the exception comes in, is for most of your chromosomes, they can represent all of the SNPs represented without having to scroll too much along the screen. And so each one of those pixels represents a single SNP. However, you'll notice that there is an image size reduction 1/2 on some of those chromosomes. And what that means is this was so large that they actually had to go and divide it in half. And so each one of those tick marks represent 200 SNPs, but it's still a SNP scale. Our chromosomes from 1 to 22 are ordered by the number of megabases. So chromosome number 1 is the longest, chromosome number 22 is the shortest. So normally when we're looking at full resolution, you'd actually think that chromosome number 1 should be the longest one and chromosome number 22 should be the shortest one. However, because we're looking at SNPs, it all depends on how many SNPs were tested on each chromosome. So you can see on this one, I have chromosome 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7. Now chromosome number 1 is showing that it's shorter than chromosome number 2, but really all that means is there was just fewer SNPs tested on chromosome number 1 than on chromosome number 2. You can also see that chromosome number 4, 5, and 7 are even longer than chromosome number 2 or 1. But that's not because the chromosomes are longer. It's because chromosome number 1 and 2 in this case were actually reduced by half, and chromosome numbers 4, 5, and 7 are not reduced by half. So don't get confused when you're looking at the full resolution that the SNP scale, which is each one of those pixels and it's what the actual length of this graphic is it's the SNPs. Don't get that confused with the overall length of the chromosome. That is not what the representation of the length of the chromosome is. So then what is the representation of the length of the chromosome? Now I told you that the scale for absolute length was megabases. How are megabases shown on these graphics? Well, that scale is at the bottom, and you can see that it has this K and 30M. And what this is position 30 million or 30 megabases. And underneath that, there is a little caret mark. And each one of those caret marks represent 1 megabase. So if you actually go between 30 and 40 megabases, you'll count 10 of those caret marks. So this is a way when you're actually zooming in, you can see roughly what position, absolute position, something is in. What you can also see is that the actual length between any two of these marks is a little bit different. There's some of these that are shorter, like this one, and there's some of them that are longer, like this one. And again, that's because the graphic is sized based on the number of SNPs. But this bottom scale is the megabases. And so in some places, there's more SNPs per megabase, and in other places there's fewer SNPs per megabase. That's why you're seeing the variation in the size of the gap between any two of those carats. Now finally we have the Centrimorgans scale. Now it would be great if we had a third line on there that had the Centrimorgans for it. However, remember I said that Centrimorgans is based on probability. And because it varies as far as how much length all throughout the human genome, there's really no good way to show how much Centrimorgans alongside the SNPs and the megabases when we're doing that graphic. But if you are looking at the table, it will tell you how much Centrimorgans is in that segment. So for instance, if I'm looking at the second segment on here from 241 megabases to 249 megabases, it's about 7.5 megabases long. And I can see that it is about 15.4 centimorgans. So there are about 2 centimorgans for every megabase in that segment. On the other hand, if I look at the very first segment, I see that it is going from about 30 megabases to 164 megabases, so about 130 megabases long, and there's 117.9 centimorgans. There is actually less than 1 centimorgan for every megabase over that segment. And so you can see that even just on this chromosome number 1, the amount of centimorgans per megabase varies from below 1 to 2 or more centimorgans per megabase. Understanding these different scales of how we measure DNA is really important when we're looking at visual phasing. Visual phasing, the idea is that we line up these graphics and we can start to see where common recombination points are between siblings. But sometimes we may run into a little problem where things don't line up exactly. So for instance, here I'm looking at my grandfather and me, and I'm looking at it with one of them from a 23andMe version 3 kit and one of them with an Ancestry version 2 kit. Now again, these both use a different set of SNPs, and so we're going to see some differences between them. Let me go through and highlight some of those. Now first, I've tried to line up the megabases for each one of these into about the same spot. And we can see that, yeah, this starting place is right about the same, and to the left of it, there are some red tick marks, although there's a lot more red tick marks on the upper one as opposed to the lower one. But those red tick marks indicate that that segment is not shared in common with me and my grandfather. Now, as we're going along the DNA and just going from left to right as we go over, we can see that there's some parts that they're starting to line up, it looks like, but they're not necessarily exactly in line with what we would think. They're maybe offset a little bit, not by too much, but just enough that you may get confused when you're starting to look at more people as far as where some of those recombination points are. So let me show you how this can be even more confused when we add another version of these same two people with a different kit. So I've brought up now the living DNA kit. Now the living DNA kit shares much less SNPs with the Ancestry or the 23andMe version 3 or version 4 kit. So I wouldn't expect to see as much information, and you can see that just from the distortion of it. This actually, when I imported this file, this graphic was only about a third of the size of these other two in relation. But I've lined it up as best as I could, and what we can see here is we can see that, hey, here is where that segment is starting. Just immediate to the left of it, we have those red segments right there, and right there. Now this is where it's important to start looking at some of the scales. So this starting point is at 30 million. If I go back to the next tick mark and the next tick mark, there's 1, 2 tick marks there, 1, 2 there, 1, 2 there. So this is between 28 million and 30 million. Besides the red marks that are immediately next to that 30 million, you'll notice that on the 23andMe version 3 And on the ancestry, there are a few other tick marks that are also red, but I don't see any of those in the living DNA. And that's because those SNPs are not ones that overlapped, and so they couldn't show up as not matching. Now, if you were looking at this, you might even begin to think, well, this may be a match. And if you actually put the threshold low enough, then it's going to show up as a match, even though it may not be. And that's just one of the importances of looking at the amount of overlap. So now let me look at the right-hand side just a bit. Again, we have this first little batch of, you know, lots of green that's almost lined up, and it looks like it's about lined up with what we see in the living DNA. And I can do that by checking out my tick marks. This is the first tick mark after that 30 million, so this represents 31 million, and those all are within that little area right there. Now, as I go a little bit further, some of these get a little bit harder to see because of the lack of overlap on these SNPs. So let me go to the next tick mark. This is going to be 32 million. One thing you will notice is between the first two, they're about the same length as far as the number of SNPs that are being represented in both of them. But on the living DNA, besides the fact that this living DNA has already been stretched out, it's also still a shorter distance, and so there's much less SNPs in this area than what I see in the other. And one thing that I can show is that on this second one, there's almost all of it is green, and even on the first one, a sizable amount of this is green between these areas. Whereas when I look down on the living DNA one, you'll notice it's really only about half and half between green and yellow. So there's a lot of those similar SNPs that were not tested on the living DNA, but were tested on the others. Now, where this can be a problem is if you had a small segment in visual phasing where there was actually two recombinations really close together, if you're using different companies' kits that don't have as much overlap, you may miss where those recombination points are. So there's a couple of ways that this represents itself. Is it represents itself then with areas that are not lining up exactly how you would expect? It's also with colors not being the same because some of those SNPs were not tested in common. Now, because of these SNPs not being tested in common, again, you can see as I go to these other data points, they don't line up near as much. And that's because there's not as much data that has been tested between them. And so whenever I'm doing visual phasing and lining up my graphs, they're not always going to line up. And so it's important that we go in and we take a look at the actual location, the megabases, of where segments start and where segments end. Those are the three scales that we use, megabases, SNPs, and centimorgans, and they can be visualized in different ways. Gedmatch has a way that you can actually see all that data at one time. It's important to remember, because they have different bases as to how those measurements are made, when we're lining them up, not everything's going to line up always the way that we want. And so be sure you know what you're looking at whenever you are looking at segment data, particularly when you're doing visual phasing. If you have any questions about the scales we use in measuring DNA, you can put it in the comments below and I'll try to answer it. And if you like this video, be sure to give it a thumbs up and share it with all your friends.